He was a young father, a once promising rugby player from Taranaki, but also a criminal with a long rap sheet. Then on a cold night in April, Kaoss Price was shot dead by police. He was unarmed. Tonight, John Campbell visits Kaoss's home in Whangamōmona and asks his whānau what happened that changed and ultimately ended his life.
At a makeshift memorial on State Highway 3 between New Plymouth and Waitara.
No, my son. How are you?
Gillian Harness speaks to a son who will never reply.
I miss you.
She keeps repeating it as the traffic roars by. Past the place where her son was shot dead.
I miss you, my boy.
Price was unarmed. He's the fifth person to be fatally shot by police in Taranaki.
This is how the country saw him in the days after his death. His mum prefers this. Yes, his name was Kaoss, but before he lived up to his name, he was Gillian's beautiful little boy. But by the age of 22, Kaoss Price would be dead. His mum rushed to the scene to be with him at the end.
Went running over by the police, hysterical, telling them who I was and asking if I could go see my son. My son had been shot, why can't I be there?
What did they say to you?
They said I couldn't. They couldn't let anyone through, even though if I was his mother. They couldn't tell me anything that was happening.
No. Okay, he was a little shit, which he was. I'm not denying that.
Marg knows who Kaoss was. His grandmother on his father's side, she's not naive about him.
Thanks for having us, Marg. It's lovely to see you.
Yes, all right.
How are you going?
I'm all right. I'm all right. I'd like to see something done about this, though.
Yes, Marg knows Kaoss had a criminal record, had done time, was off the rails. It's really important that we don't. But she also knows he's dead and we don't have the death penalty. When Kaoss's body was finally released from the site, Marg was waiting for him.
We worked all night and we dressed him and got him back to the house at 7 o'clock the next morning. And I asked and they said they were the two bullet holes. It was two bullet holes in him.
Two. You're absolutely sure of that, Marg?
I am absolutely. I'd stake my life on it. I'd stake my granddaughter's life on it. I can't stake my grandson's life on it because he's dead.
Kaoss grew up here, Whangamōmona, population 130, give or take, on the Forgotten World Highway, famous for being so far from anywhere it declared itself a republic. Marg and her late husband, Mert, had the garage.
First thing Kaoss learned was to get the sawdust out of the bag. Put it on an oil spot.
Granddad Mert taught him how to undo lawnmowers when he was little, grease all his machines that he worked on.
He had his own little motor and tools that he used to play with.
Beyond the kitchen where the fridge hides, there's the classic height markings as children grow. Up he went, 2011, 2012, the days when the sky was still his limit.
He went to school up the road, used to run the gut buster. He played rugby for Toko. He played Dean Cup. He played for Taranaki.
He got selected for the rep team, eh? The under 13 rep team, right?
Yeah, and he got into it. I must find the photo of it. Yeah, that's his Taranaki tie up there.
But small towns don't hold big boys forever. And with secondary school in New Plymouth and rugby in New Plymouth, Kaoss moved west to town. The future felt solid, but the solid was full of cracks.
He was becoming a teenager and seeing everybody rag school and, you know, get into the naughtiness. Well, he wanted to be in that crowd. One day, that's when he just, you know, decided that he was an adult. I'm an adult, Mum, I can do whatever I want. So, see you later. And then he started making a life with his new girlfriend. The next minute we find out that they're having a baby.
You know, these kids do wrong things. There's a lot more stuff around these days that kids can get their hands on than was ever around, ever.
Kaoss was getting his hands on plenty. Petty crime, burglary, theft, reckless driving, failing to stop for police. By the time he turned 21, he'd been sent to prison where he got that facial tattoo.
He did say to me, Nana, you might like it.
The tattoo. Did you like the tattoo, honestly?
Of course. It was always said, never get one on your face, but, you know, they'll do what they do.
Who knows what he was thinking when the end came. It was a Saturday night in April. He was driving that stretch of road between New Plymouth and Waitara when a car he was travelling with was pulled over. He did a U-turn and drove back into the police car. What happened next is under investigation, but a witness says he was shot in the car, got out of the car unarmed, was running, and was shot again.
Why did they have to shoot him the second time? Why didn't they just cuff him and take him into custody? That's what you would normally do, wouldn't you? Why use such excessive force for a situation like that?
There'll be some people watching this who say if he hadn't driven his car that way that night, he'd still be alive now. And so, you know, therefore, it's his fault.
No, it's not his fault. He got out of that car. He was not armed. Right. If they had the fear that he was armed, as soon as he got out of that car, they proved he wasn't armed. My grandson, they didn't have to do that.
Five grandsons. Five men shot dead here by police in 22 years. Stephen Wallace, then Anthony Ratahi, Adam Moirihu, Alan Rowe, and then Kaoss Price himself. Four of them Māori.
How many of them did you know?
I knew four of the five men. The first one being Stephen Wallace, went to high school with him.
Taranaki is a patchwork of hurts. Dini Moirihu, New Plymouth District Councillor, mayoral candidate, has them in his very DNA.
You are at my tūranga waiwai, my whānau's marae, Mururaupatu, just on Te Ari Road.
Inside the Wharenui, Dini's tūpuna face him from the far wall. Here he can travel a direct line back to his great-great-grandparents.
To my left is my great-grandfather, Percy, or Pehi Mana Tamati, and to my right is his son, Ted Tamati. And then next to Ted is my great-great-grandfather, Tamati Whanganui.
It was a terrible time in our history when all the land they had was simply taken from them and almost everyone they knew here and throughout Taranaki.
So with Tamati Whanganui, we found documentation of him being imprisoned without trial.
Without trial?
Without trial.
Removed from his own land?
Removed from his own land.
The land here is another lost soul. 1.2 million acres were confiscated in Taranaki. Perhaps most infamously here at Parihaka in 1881. In 2017, the Crown came to apologise. So much damage done. Such a very long time to acknowledge it.
The Crown took the rich lands of Taranaki and left its people impoverished, demoralised and vilified.
I think when you are part of lived history, where you see the continued dispossession and disenfranchisement, it takes a lot to navigate and work through that.
Dini Moirihu is running for mayor. He believes power is a great antidote to powerlessness.
So 140 years later, how many Māori mayors have there been in Taranaki?
From From what I know, there has never been the Māori mea in Taranaki. When you think about it, and me being the second Māori to be elected onto a city council in almost 100 years, it speaks volumes to...
The second Māori to be elected onto the council in almost 100 years.
Yeah. And to that city council, yes.
Representation matters. On Thursday morning in Porirua, after 16 weeks at police college, 76 mostly young people began their lives as police officers.
We've had a 36% growth in Māori officers since 2017. That is shaping the nature of the front line.
Commissioner of Police, Andrew Costa.
Is it an easy time to be a police officer?
No, I don't think there's ever been a harder time, frankly.
What's happening in Taranaki? Going back to Steve Wallace in the year 2000, there's been 5 deaths by police shootings in the 22 years since. Is something going wrong there?
I know that that is a question worth asking. I think the number of incidents is too small to be confident that it's something unusual, as opposed to actually they've had a bad run.
So what would you say to Kaoss Price's whānau? They feel terribly betrayed by what they see as an excessive use of force. What would you say to them?
No police officer goes to work wanting to use the kind of force that leads to someone's death. Our frontline deal with some incredibly difficult situations where there is no straightforward way to ensure the safety of all people involved. And so I feel for the family, but I also know that our people do tough work in tough environments.
Kaoss Price wasn't armed, was he? When he was out of that car, he wasn't armed. Should he have been shot a second time?
I just can't speak to those specifics, John. I need to let those inquiries run their course and respect that people will look at those things carefully.
We need to get this right. You sense these young people feel the responsibility of that, that they're determined to be a force for good. Some kids become cops. Some kids get chased by cops. We need to keep all of them as safe as we possibly can.
We can only be there to try and guide them and hopefully they follow that way, but it's up to them. I wish I could do much for Kaoss. I wish I did a lot more for Kaoss.
You know, he was only 22. He was still a kid himself. Even though he was a parent, he was still really a child himself. And I'm sure he would have grown out what he was in, because underneath that, he had a kind heart. He had a good heart if you knew him as I knew him.
Well, Kaoss Price's death is being investigated by the Independent Police Conduct Authority. Police won't say whether the officers involved are back at work or when the investigation will be completed.